Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Our program will start in 5 minutes. Before we begin, here are a few reminders to ensure a smooth virtual event experience. Pleasant day to you, art managers, art teachers, and art directors, and everyone here this morning. I am Martin Lopez, and this is day two of Crosslight online learning sessions. In this four-part webinar series, we celebrate our artistic solidarity as a region and learn from strongholds how to rediscover and reignite our creative drive during these trying times. Last week, we officially kicked off the series by learning about the healing power of art. We heard how National Artist for Music, Brian Kayabya, used his primary passion to help the less fortunate during the pandemic. We also learned how Singaporean dance legend, Santha Bhaskar, brought her stylings to a brand new stage. Finally, we witnessed how Professor Hu Hongyi proved that the show does, in fact, always go on. This week will be the first of a two-part installment where we will learn more on how to manage the arts and empower young artists and cultural workers as we continue braving the new normal. Just like last week, the speakers we will be meeting today originate from different countries and different fields. They will tackle a variety of topics, including arts and talent management, as well as strategic leadership. I'm sure they can explain them better than I can. So without further ado, let us proceed with the webinar. Our first virtual guest is based in Bangkok and is an expert in synergizing the fields of education, arts, and civil society. She currently serves as the Interim Regional Arts Director for the British Council in Southeast Asia, under which she heads initiatives on developing new propositions across different thematic areas like creative and social entrepreneurship and creative youth development programs. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Julia Kim-Davies.
Hello and good morning to you all. My name is Julia Kim-Davies and I'm the British Council Partnership Director for Southeast Asia and I'm based in Bangkok, Thailand. I'm really sorry that I was not able to join you live today. However, I'm really grateful to be given this speaking opportunity courtesy of the ASEAN University Network on Culture and the Arts and the Philippines Commission on Higher Education. My presentation this morning will focus on the way that arts organizations within the ASEAN region have responded to the situation they faced as a result of the global pandemic. So maybe just briefly for those not familiar with the British Council, we are the UK's international organisation for cultural relations and educational opportunities, building connections, understanding and trust between people in the UK and other countries through our three pillars, being arts and culture, education and the English language. We essentially work in two ways, so directly with individuals and with governments and partners to make a bigger difference for the longer term, creating benefit for millions of people all over the world. We connect the best of the UK with the world and the best of the world with the UK. These connections lead to an understanding of each other's strengths and of the challenges and values that we share. Ultimately, this builds trust between people in the UK and other nations. Since the outbreak of the pandemic in early 2020, as an organization, we have been tracking the catastrophic social and economic impact the pandemic has had on the creative industries and the cultural and heritage sectors more broadly, both within the UK, globally, and also within our region. This was important so that we could better understand what kind of response we could make and that would be most relevant and appropriate. So about a year ago, colleagues in the UK held consultations with their respective art form disciplines, and it was really useful in guiding our response. What we learned was that artists and creative professionals have been among the hardest hit in this crisis due to the fragility of the sector, with many being self-employed, employed in small and medium-sized enterprises, and in some cases working in the informal sector. For the UK's cultural sector, the impact of the first lockdown was immediate and immediately catastrophic. No audiences, no places to gather, perform, or exhibit. Empty high streets, shuttered theatres, galleries, and museums. And for the freelancers, who are the lifeblood of the arts, an overnight loss of income. Hope for the future came via cash and loan support from the UK government, which was the biggest single investment in culture in our history. The day after the first lockdown was announced, the Arts Council had committed £160 million to individuals and organisations on the brink of collapse. Following that initial investment, the government's Culture Recovery Fund has been a critical lifeline. The first tranche of funding in government grants and loans delivered last autumn was intended to help the arts simply survive. 3,000 organisations from nightclubs to concert halls received help. The emergency funding packages helped to safeguard the livelihoods of artists, artisans and creative professionals in the short-term period. Some of these include commissioning new works, often adapted to the new reality of the digital environment, to provide a continued income for individuals and access to culture for society as a whole. An astonishing amount has been produced by creatives of all kinds who are desperate to work and desperate to help its citizens get through lockdown. They use their emergency funding to give online music lessons, to stream plays, to offer close-ups of great works of art and a thousand other things to keep the spirits up. Thanks to them and to everyone who kept making, filming, streaming, writing and playing, the last year has been a time of heightened creativity and innovation. Simultaneously, we were also tracking the impact on education and learning. Globally, we started to witness ministries of education mandating that schools and higher education institutions must close in order to curb the COVID-19 spread, which led to an unprecedented rise in online learning and remote teaching, almost overnight. We noticed that online communication and productivity apps finally made it to the top 10 list, ending the domination of having solely entertainment and games apps up there. Zoom, until early March of 2020, was almost not present at all, and it was massively downloaded in all markets. Google Classroom and Microsoft Teams were downloaded and used in countries that chose to back up their TV classes by introducing these online collaboration tools. While we would need to research this deeper, it seems that the full online teaching experience should be more than just a face-to-face model turned to a video call. Online collaboration that supports assignment submission, feedback, and course participant interaction can be a vital part of that approach, as it may be an important element during the purchasing decision, but also it tackles motivation, dedication, and overall learner satisfaction. So similar to the education sector, the pandemic also prompted an unprecedented worldwide acceleration in the digitization of culture, with lockdowns resulting in a massive expansion in online consumption of, but also participation in the arts and culture. In June last year, we published an article on the state of the sector in East Asia at the height of the pandemic. We reported a variety of differing responses from national governments across the region, as well as support coming from the private sector and from the sector itself. Across the region, national level responses for the arts and cultural sector initially focused on policies and measures designed to provide guidelines or immediate short-term financial relief. It was noted that financial packages were not consistently available throughout the region, however. A few noteworthy examples were in Singapore, which provided rental waivers for arts organizations, as well as digital presentation grants, whilst in the Philippines, the Ministry of Culture provided support through digital transformation skills and by contracting freelancers to support the government in its COVID-19 response. In Thailand, the Creative Economy Agency, or the CEA, implemented measures to help entrepreneurs in the creative industries. To mitigate the impact of the outbreak on artists, one example of their project saw support to 30 artists and designers to create works of art for Charangkorong, which is a district in central Bangkok. Greater solidarity across the sector has been a common reaction to this crisis, particularly in Southeast Asia. Artists in the Philippines were offering skills workshops and design services at home to build the skills of the people in their community who were out of work. Vietnamese artists came together to auction some 100 paintings through the Viet Art Exchange public group on Facebook in March last year to raise funds for the fight against the pandemic. Artists are ready to contribute to raising awareness about COVID-19, be it through commissioned work for posters in Vietnam or design opportunities offered by the government in Thailand. Many art professionals have created initiatives to assess the impact and demonstrate the value of arts and culture in this crisis. The I Lost My Gig platform in the Philippines, Australia, and New Zealand is one of those and is collecting data on lost business. We also saw a shift to explore creativity as a form of resilience. Artists across the region adapted to shutdowns in a variety of ways, with many swapping physical performances spaces for virtual ones. Like their counterparts in the UK, Indonesian artists and cultural organizations have moved to online platforms. Jakarta's Makan Museum launched a museum from home, a compilation of various materials and inspiring activities to do while working and studying from home. Future 10 live streams, DJ performances, and virtual concerts are offered by Studio Rama and Sounds from the Corner. New partnerships have emerged with crowdfunding platforms like Kitabisa, Saweria, and fintech payment gateways like GoPay. However, in many parts of the world, let us also be reminded that digital solutions are still not an option. An estimated 3.6 billion people remain totally offline. Particularly, in developing countries. In some countries, digital penetration is only around 35%, meaning that 2 in 3 people do not yet have access to online content. The Indonesia Creative Cities Network, a node of creative cross-community organizations with networks in more than 200 districts and cities in Indonesia, initiated a nationwide integrated program. This is an emergency response to domestic conditions due to COVID-19 pandemic to support communities and the cultural sector. A key part of the initiative is the Indonesia Creative Store, an online and offline stores that will promote and sell a variety of products by creative communities from various regions in Indonesia. We also saw how the creative sector supported the social sector with many examples of people working beyond their sector coming from Southeast Asia, where there is always a strong sense of solidarity and volunteerism. We documented the role that creative hubs play in connecting and supporting local communities. For example, the Fab Lab Cafe in Bangkok galvanized the makers community in supporting medical staff in providing equipment and design solutions, such as developing mobile applications to track the spread of COVID-19. We witnessed crowdfunding platforms and government agency in Thailand supporting these endeavors. So this is perhaps a good segue, and I'll now move to talk about the way that we pivoted our programming last year in order to support arts and cultural professionals in ASEAN. So between May and July of 2020, we hosted Communities of a New Future, which was a three-part series of Creative Hub conversations that gathered Creative Hub managers and their community leaders. It provided a platform where the creative sector could share, connect, and build a community of trust amidst an unprecedented global crisis. This initiative was supported by the British Council Creative Hubs for Good program, which aims to support the development of creative hubs to be key drivers and catalysts for good in their communities. The program, active across Southeast Asia, in Thailand, in Malaysia, the Philippines, and in Indonesia, connects hub managers together, encourages exchanges of experiences and best practices, increases and enhances the capacity of creative hubs, and advocates for the importance of creative hubs. The British Council Indonesia Arts team hosted the opening session for this series, called Inspiring Resilience, and examined the short-term responses of creative hubs. A panel of creative hub speakers from Indonesia, Scotland, and Malaysia were brought together to share how they were coping their respective hubs' initiatives and the support that they had been receiving and offering to their communities. We asked participants what actions their organizations had taken as a response to the crisis. What we learned was that a majority of respondents had stopped on-site activities and programs and had partially or totally moved their operations and offerings online. Most had also engaged in new projects or partnerships, whilst others planned to support theirs most direct. This indicated to us a strong need for support in terms of online transitioning skills and new project collaboration ideas. We also asked if participants would be interested to collaborate with other creative hubs. A total of 180 respondents stated that they were interested in to collaborate with other creative hubs. Training, knowledge sharing, and mentoring was the other intersection of collaboration which respondents were interested in. Respondents were also keen to look into innovative and sustainable business models and methods to sustain their operations and creative businesses. The second talk was hosted by the British Council Philippines Arts team and was called Lessons on Digital Transformation. And this session focused on the medium-term responses of creative hubs. The speakers from the Philippines, Indonesia, and Scotland discussed how organizations could digitally transform to stay relevant and engaged in a changed and uncertain world. We asked participants about their skills requirements, and we learned that respondents had a much higher need for skills in comparison to the skills they currently have. The top three skills respondents have are content curation, graphic design, and creative problem solving, whereas the bottom three skills were blockchain, artificial intelligence, and mobile app development. However, respondent survey told us that data analysis and visualization, content curation, and strategic communication were the three most needed skills. Our third and final talk, Reimagining the Future of Creative Hubs, was hosted by the Malaysia Arts Team and was held in July. The session had speakers from Malaysia and Wales and looked at the longer term opportunities of creative hubs. Participants were involved in discussions to rethink how we work, deliver, and create meaningful interactions with our communities to support a more sustainable ecosystem. The speakers each delved into the topic with design thinking, data analysis, and policymaking. When surveyed, 68% of participants were interested to collaborate at a regional and international level, and a large majority of the respondents expressed an interest to be involved in a series of collaborative digital workshops organized by the British Council in the future. So in conclusion, the forum attendees expressed an interest to collaborate and be a part of some smaller digital style workshops. Most respondents suggested that they lacked the funding and ideas to collaborate, and there was also a strong and equal need for digital skills training to encourage more collaborations. So learning from the communities of a new future discussion, from the stories of resilience, challenges, and creative adaptations and insights gathered from 400 Creative Hub leaders in Southeast Asia and the UK, we learned that a critical need included the knowledge to digitize program delivery and new means of engaging and supporting their communities. The Creative Communities Learning Lab program was built over the course of 8 months last year and sought to directly respond to the learning needs of Creative Hub leaders, artists, creative entrepreneurs, and cultural professionals. It offers self-style courses designed with specific input from Creative Hub leaders and their communities in Southeast Asia and the UK. Registration for the modules is free, and there are three themes that the producers from Southeast Asia and the UK have developed into three course modules. So course one is called Digital Community Strategy and Management. And this course focuses on new ways to encourage, engage, and maintain communities online, building on existing patterns of peer support and collective sense-making. This course also provides guidance on how to measure creative value added and evaluate the effectiveness of a digital community strategy and management. The second course is Ways to Monetize Creative Services. And this course brings together practice-oriented insights and knowledge from the UK and from right across the Southeast Asia Creative Hubs community to explore innovative ways to digitize and monetize creative work. Contents include building confidence in monetizing hybrid revenue streams, strategies for creators with limited internet connectivity, as well as effective translating creative work online. And the last course, Bringing Your Training Online, which may be of relevance to most of the audience members today, focuses on online skills training, outlining the key steps of a typical design process, useful digital platforms, and pedagogical approaches that can help create a compelling learning experience. A key goal is to empower Creative Hub leaders and creative professionals to develop original, bespoke digital learning content. So just to end, here are four key observations that we learned from listening to creative professionals in Southeast Asia over the past year. So firstly, the impact caused by COVID-19 has put artists, entrepreneurs, and cultural organizations at more risk than ever before. Cancelled projects, disrupted operations, limited access to resources, and decreased mobility call for coordinated and long-term solutions for the creative hub sector. Secondly, the need for strong networks and united communities that support the well-being of creative groups under stress is more crucial than ever. Third, during this difficult time, creative hubs in Southeast Asia have given a voice to thousands of artists and creative entrepreneurs who have been heavily impacted by COVID-19. And lastly, creative hubs are often under-supported and underappreciated by institutions and stakeholders. In addition, creative hub managers lack the necessary skills and business know-how to sustain their hub and effectively communicate their enormous value in society. So thank you so much for listening, and we really welcome audience members to directly engage with us. Collectively, we can find more sustainable and equitable pathways for the creative communities across ASEAN and beyond. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Julia, for all your dedication and effort. Not to mention that instant crash course. If there's one thing we learned, art is definitely more than creating and performing. There's also a science behind managing it. I encourage our audience to read more on the British Council and its projects and advocacies. Ladies and gentlemen, as Ms. Julia mentioned in her presentation, she won't be able to join us today. So participating in the open forum later on her behalf will be the head of arts and creative industries for British Council Philippines, Ms. Malaya Del Rosario. If you have anything to ask, please prepare your questions and get ready to type them in the chat box later. For now, we will take a quick break. Don't go away. Day 2 of the AUNCA and ASEAN-based Crosslight online learning sessions will be back in 10 minutes. Welcome back. In case you just joined us, this is day two of the Aun-Ca and ACOFE's Crosslight online learning sessions. Earlier, we learned about arts management from Ms. Julia Kim-Davies of the British Council. Now, we will learn about strategic leadership in the field of the arts. If that sounds borderline technical, I assure you, our next guest will make it sound anything but. Our second plenary speaker is from home court. He's an accomplished playwright and stage director who has mounted several productions in Manila and the United States. He has helped Filipino-Americans form their own theater companies and has also taught courses in theater arts, performance arts, and Philippine studies. His greatest undertaking yet is being the current vice president and artistic director of the Cultural Center of the Philippines, under which he mounts festivals and oversees a multitude of artistic programs in the performing arts, literature, cinema, and the visual arts. Among his most notable projects was directing the spectacular presentations of the 31st ASEAN meeting held last November 2017 and the 50th anniversary celebrations of the Cultural Center of the Philippines last September 2019. More recently, he was instrumental in helping the center transition to online programming amidst quarantine. We sure want to hear more about that. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to Mr. Chris Millado.
Good afternoon from Manila, Philippines. I'm connecting from my workstation at home south of Manila, an hour away from my workplace at the Cultural Center of the Philippines, or CCP. Since the sporadic lockdowns have started March of 2020, I have been conducting most of my business from home and, when protocols allow, from my office at the CCP. To date, the Philippines topped 1.2 million COVID-19 cases, 15 months after the country recorded the first infection. The government employed measures that saw the use of the police and the military to enforce curfew, physical distancing, and other protocols that made the lockdown not only the longest in Asia, but one of the harshest. Early in 2020, concerned about the rapid spread of COVID in the Asian region, the Cultural Center of the Philippines decided to cancel its largest multi-arts festival. The Pasinaya Open House Festival could have been a potential super spreader. The theater production Batang Mujahideen, a play about child soldiers in southern Philippines, was the last live theater production seen at the center. In other parts of Manila, many other performing arts companies aborted their own productions, some of them canceling right after opening night. Performing arts companies and artists often compare opening nights to giving birth after months of gestating, developing and rehearsing an idea until the production is finally ushered into the world. The painful experience of ending the creative process prematurely has become part of the trauma caused by this emergency. Curator Dr. Patrick Flores puts forward a definition of emergency. He points out that the term comes from the Latin emergere, meaning to bring to light and to arise, a moment of crisis, a delicate moment between survival and perdition. But it is also an opportunity to deliberate and decide what to do in a time suspended between life and death. During the several months of being locked up at our places of quarantine, we found ourselves reeling from the seemingly unstoppable and unpredictable ways of COVID-19. We cringed in the shadows of sleeplessness and woke to the horrible news of loved ones succumbing to the virus. How did the center and its arts managers respond to the emergency? The lockdown forced us to pause and reflect. We stepped back and allowed things to happen, patiently observed so that we could learn. We scanned and got a foothold on the changed landscape. We learned quickly and painfully that just like the rest of the country, we lacked the readiness to face the health crisis. The arts and culture sector faced massive loss of livelihood, especially among freelancers, talents, production and stage managers, designers, technicians, who compose a great majority of the arts industry workforce. Together with the entertainment and tourism sector, the arts and culture industry was expected to be the last to recover. Glimmers of strength emerged from the artist sector during the early days of the lockdown. The artists immediately took to social media, giving information, calling out for help, organizing fundraisers. The robust network that artists previously built to sustain their organizations before COVID became the social scaffolding for the distribution of digital works during the lockdown. Early adapters to digital technology, the artists easily tapped into the country's phenomenal inclination for social media. Social media penetration in the Philippines stood at 67% in January 2020. Ownership of mobile connections reached 130%, meaning many Filipinos own more than one mobile service. This connectivity made possible the opportunity to mobilize the network for an artist-led response to COVID. Digital platforms replaced print and television in delivering information and creative content and broadened the reach to communities far from the physical centers. At the Cultural Center of the Philippines, 800 events were canceled. 3,000 artists and cultural production staff stood to lose their contracts. At least 800,000 audiences would be lost due to cancellation of shows. A projected loss of 90 million in sales revenue added to the loss of opportunity for numerous printers, caterers, carpenters, electricians, food vendors that would normally service these art events. The Cultural Center of the Philippines, being a government agency, absorbed budget cuts as part of the national emergency measures. spaces at the culture complex that were being prepped for arts infrastructure were temporarily secured to become COVID quarantine facilities. The management zeroed in on what it considered was the most important call during this critical moment: to protect lives and livelihoods while continuing to deliver educational and inspiring content to Filipinos. While the vision of making art matter to every Filipino continued to be the guiding star, the center needed to revisit its strategies given the radically changed environment. This prompted a migration of content to online platforms. The center dipped into the resource that had long remained stagnant in digital archives and curated selected titles for streaming. We determined four areas of priority: arts and culture online, live arts on lockdown, arts for therapy, and capacity building. We activated the migration of selected festivals and activities to the online platform. This move necessitated the redesign of the activities and the retooling of artists and production staff to deliver online production. The annual One Act Play Festival, known as the Virgin Lab Fest, deployed artistic teams to recreate stagings of the new plays through Zoom. Stage directors learned how to mount and shoot scenes like film directors. Actors familiarized themselves with the use of computer camera software, ring lights, green screens, microphones. Production staff adapted their skills to manage rehearsals remotely. The virtual version was hailed as a breakthrough as it became the first theater festival in the Philippines that successfully migrated to the digital platform. The migration to online platforms fast-tracked the digital transformation of the institution. Digital marketing became an essential part of the learning curve as the team shifted its communication strategies to target specific demographics in social media platforms like Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. The Cinemalaya Philippine Independent Film Festival, a flagship project of the Cultural Center, showcases more than 80 freshly made and independently produced films. It has created new audiences to Philippine cinema, both locally and abroad. The pandemic caused the cancellation of film production, leaving the festival with no full-length feature films to exhibit. Built on the reputation of being a multi-platform festival that included live screenings, gala premieres, workshops, exhibits, talkbacks, the festival organizers had to figure out ways of capturing the same kind of energy as a virtual festival. The festival pushed through with the screening of short feature films in a move that proved to be an effective match to the shorter attention span of the so-called digital natives. The paying audiences were to be found on Facebook and responded to easily accessible one-click links that immediately brought them to the pay site and content platform. On the other hand, the younger followers on Instagram and Twitter had to be coaxed to subscribe through memes, posts, and teasers that appealed to their sense of fun. The shift to the digital platform enabled unexpected collaborations. Playwrights worked with the graphic designers and film editors to translate the staging of one-act plays. Choreographers collaborated with independent filmmakers to create dance and video. Choral performers collaborated with sound technicians to create three-dimensional binaural recordings of vocal performances. The need to create an online presence for smaller regional companies stimulated the formation of cooperatives for digital assets management. The center collaborated with the National Live Events Coalition to come up with the protocol standards anticipating the return to public engagements and to lobby for legislation in support of artists during and after the pandemic. Armed with the calibrated processes, the productions gingerly ventured into the space of the so-called new normal. Productions had to contend with at least 30% increase in budgets that included the employment of dedicated health officers, the expense for entry and exit swab tests for all artists and production staff, quarantine accommodations, and a contingency budget to cover all other emergencies. Once the projects were implemented under the new condition, we recalibrated so we could begin again armed with the useful learnings. the digital version of the Encyclopedia of Philippine Art, which was supposed to be launched in 2021, had to be fast-tracked to respond to the needs of teachers seeking online resources for their remote classroom sessions. The artist trainers of the center collaborated with the curriculum developers of the Department of Education to come up with learning modules to be used for online teaching. Cope, calibrate, collaborate, confront, recalibrate, repeat. This, in a nutshell, illustrates the learning cycle that have been useful for the survival of our arts programs in the time of the great pandemic lockdown. I realized that most of these survival skills I learned from my theater training. During those critical moments, I recall the voice of my drama teacher side coaching us during improvisation class. Stay focused, keep to your point of concentration, stick to the objective, be in the moment, listen with your whole being, roll with the punches. Last September, as I stood with a small team of creatives to witness the sound and light show at the center's front lawn, and as the logo of the institution animated on the facade, I began to reflect on what that symbol meant to me. The logo of the Cultural Center of the Philippines is a composite of three letter Ks written in Baybayin or the ancient Tagalog script. The three Ks stand for katotohanan, the true, kabutihan, the good, and kagandahan, the beautiful, the values that guide the center's artistic endeavors. During the pandemic, these new meanings have emerged for me. Katotohanan is truth in art that exposes disinformation and combats historical revisionism. As much as we delight in the ease and access to information made possible by online technology, we should remain critically alert on how these platforms could be used to spread disinformation and weaponized to suppress truth. Kabutihan is goodness in art that channels empathy and promotes meaningful human connections. Connectivity in digital terms is defined as the capacity for interconnection of platforms, systems, and applications. But how can we make art circulate in the blood, sweat, and tears of our people? Participating in change by liking and posting emoticons makes us keyboard warriors. But how do we make these virtual gestures take root on the ground and grow them into a commitment for social change? Kagandahan is beauty in art that reflects the collective experience of our people, their small victories, their hopes, their struggles, their epic failures, their shining acts of kindness, their tragic acts of cruelty. As we slide into the safety and comfort of remoteness and isolation, it is easy to forget the vibrancy of our gatherings, the ritual of heading to places of performance, finding ourselves with kindred souls at the lobbies, settling into a collective hush as the lights go down, laughing and gasping with a room full of virtual strangers, bursting into applause at the end of the show, going home with the headiness of a fine performance, all this making us less estranged and more connected. This is the power of art as congregational experience.
Sampai jumpa.
I believe that the return to powerful live interaction between artists and audiences is nearing. But for now, we cope by continuing to create meaning and reach out to each other using digital and hybrid platforms. Our physical buildings lie in wait, but in several spaces within it, and in the homes, the studios, the streets, the fields, and numerous spaces outside of it, the art continues.
That, dear guests, was a peek into how one of Asia's biggest cultural institutions keeps up with the times. Thank you so much for sharing that with us, Mr. Millado. Of course, thank you for reminding us of the importance of innovation and studying audience behavior, especially during a crisis. Mr. Millado will be back later for the open forum. Please prepare your questions. We are going on another 10-minute break. Please don't go away. We will be hearing from our third plenary speaker after the break. Welcome back to day two of Crosslight online learning sessions. Before the break, we learned the basics of strategic management from the Cultural Center of the Philippines' Vice President and Artistic Director, Mr. Chris Millado. Now, it is time to meet today's third plenary speaker. Our last guest for today is a published author who spent nearly three decades of her professional life pushing for the integration of arts and education. In between, she also collaborated with various international arts organizations, such as the Really Useful Group and Cirque du Soleil. And how's this as an example of coming full circle? She is now head of talent development and programming for the National University of Singapore Center for the Arts, the school from which she earned her master's degree in literature. Under her current post, she is in charge of mentoring 20 on-campus arts groups and creating various platforms for arts engagement for her community. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ms. Mary Law Chieu Kwuan.
Good morning, Dr. Chotis Deratiri, Deputy Executive Director of the ASEAN University Network, Attorney Lily Frida Makabangun Miller from the Commission of Higher Education, Ms. Glory Faye Samodio, Chairperson AUNCA, representatives from the ASEAN University Network, and representatives of Association of Cultural Officers in Philippine Education Institutions, distinguished artists and fellow arts managers, greetings from NUS Center for the Arts. It is indeed my privilege to be speaking to you on day two of the inaugural Crosslight Learning Sessions. We are facing a crisis of immense proportions where daily millions are dying. Economies are crippled and almost all aspects of human life have been adversely affected. While some may consider the development of student artists somewhat of a lower priority in comparison to these pressing issues, we believe that it is critical to speak of these things in the present before it impacts our future. And beyond this pandemic, there will be a future, however uncertain it is. Let's first begin with a few definitions. The phrase new normal. According to the Collins Dictionary, it refers to a hitherto unusual or unfamiliar situation that has become expected or typical. The term first surfaced around 1918 in reference to conditions of human life after World War I and subsequently used after tragic events such as the financial crisis of 2007, the global recession of 2008 to 2012, and currently with the COVID pandemic. It is characterized by a season of deep-rooted change affecting all aspects of human life, uncertainty and fear of the unknown. When we speak of the student artist, we refer to a student who's pursuing a formal course of study in the arts, such as music, dance, drama, or film, with the possibility that he or she may choose the arts as a vocation. A student artist could also be a student who pursues an interest in the arts without an expectation that he may choose a career in the arts. The level of commitment will be equally high, and yet the latter may lean towards pursuing his interests via co-curricular and extracurricular activities. How has COVID-19 affected arts education in institutions of higher learning? Most recently in the UK, it was announced that the government would cut funding for arts and design courses by 50% across higher education institutions. Gavin Williamson, the Education Secretary, indicated that funding from the Office for Students, or OFS, which is the independent regulator of higher education, would be cut by half for students of art and design, music, dance, drama and performing arts, media studies and archaeology during the 2021 to 2022 academic year. Instead, Williamson proposed that the OFS should reprioritize funding towards the provision of high-cost, high-value subjects that support the national health system and high-cost STEM subjects. The decision to slash funding for arts education seems baffling in the light of the fact that graduates in creative-focused universities add £8.4 billion in income to the UK economy each year. Research from Universities UK found that higher education was the primary producer of the talents and skills that feed the creative industries and an important source of research that informs new ideas, practices, and business models. Without nurturing this stream of new talent, what is the impact on creative industries post-pandemic? In an article, Arts Education is on the Endangered Species List in Australia, Kay Tucker reports that the response to the pandemic has accelerated and deepened a protracted attack on the arts and humanities. From this year, the following cuts and mergers are scheduled. Monash University in Melbourne will cut its theatre studies and musicology programs. Similarly, Newcastle and La Trobe University will abolish its drama departments. Griffith University's Queensland College of the Arts will cut courses in fine arts, photography and design. Flinders University in South Australia will temporarily pause enrolling students in its acting degree. Australian National University in Canberra will downgrade its art schools. The University of New South Wales Faculty of Arts and Design in Sydney will become part of a larger faculty that will see the merger of arts and social sciences with art and design and built environment. And the University of Tasmania is cutting courses from 514 to 120. As noted arts management academic Professor Joe Koss states very clearly, the capacity for the country to continue to train a range of future performers, directors, musicians, artists, writers and curators will be dramatically affected, creating a bleak and uninspiring future for our young people. Last week, we were deeply saddened to hear of how members of the ASEAN University Network have faced similar challenges, even to the extent of closure of cultural offices and the reduction of much needed resources such as funding and manpower. As the battle of COVID continues, greater reductions are expected in this industry. It would seem that at this time, the value of an arts education is being weighed against an education in technology and science, subjects that might produce more economic benefits and serve to restore jobs and businesses more quickly, and in comparison, the arts are considered non-essential. How has COVID-19 affected arts co-curricular programs? Restrictions include closure of venues for practice and performance, strict measures for control such as temperature taking and masks, limits of numbers of participants, no singing and playing of wind and brass instruments, production support reduced in terms of funding and manpower. There is now a need to be able to deliver good digital productions, but the students lack the necessary technical skills. There is also competition for viewership on digital productions, and there is the difficulty of monetizing viewership and therefore affecting future plans of the group for the growth of the group. I believe that it would not be necessary in this company of artists and arts managers to go into any great detail about why the arts are vital for life. But I would like to highlight four reasons that we must continue to push for the arts in higher education. According to the World Economic Forum's 2020 report on the future of jobs, the top 10 skills that would be in great demand are analytical thinking and innovation, active learning and learning strategies, complex problem solving, critical thinking and analysis, creativity, originality and initiative, leadership and social influence, technology use and monitoring and control, technology design and programming, resilience, stress, tolerance and flexibility, reasoning, problem solving and ideation. Of these, the arts can play an important role towards future-proofing our students, especially those highlighted in red. Curiosity is foundational to critical thinking. The ability to ask questions, to frame and reframe these questions, cultivates the ability to see the negative space when drawing, or for a dancer to learn a new choreography and incorporate the movement with meaning and technique. Language is code, and all art forms expose you to a new language with a new set of rules and vocabulary. Learning music theory is like learning code. Learning new choreography is learning to think in patterns. Cultural fluency. Working with the arts exposes you to explore people's geographies and paradigms different from your own. Openness to thought diversity and forming tribes to catalyze and complete work becomes a very important part of future work skills. The repertoire model. The foundation, conceptual thinking and cultural influence are the start. As they mature, Artists must feel that they would like to broaden their learning to adopt new challenges and expand with new contexts. This corresponds to active learning. Leadership and vision. It is very easy to copy and paste, and originality and capacity to stand out really depends upon an artistic vision of a leader. This is not taught in business school. Secondly, in an increasingly connected world where my virtual workplace will be shared by colleagues all over the world, there is a need to develop skills for cross-cultural collaboration and communication. As earlier mentioned, artists have always drawn from cultures separated by geography and time. This encourages diversity of thought, which is necessary in a cross-cultural environment. Third, medical experts warn that the next pandemic would be one of mental illness caused by fear, social isolation, and loneliness experienced during the pandemic. Painting a picture, creating a work of music, and performing a dance may express the deeply felt emotions where language alone may not suffice. Catharsis experienced by the viewer and by the performer. Mastery of skills in performance also deliver confidence not just in the art, but in self-esteem and personal empowerment, and return some sense of control. This is essentially how resilience is built. The arts play an important part in ensuring the mental wellness of our youth. Finally, the arts will soon play another role in the post-pandemic world as a means of helping people record and understand what they have lived through. Some of the impact of the worst pandemics in history have been recorded in famous works of art. In an article in the Straits Times, Ms. Ong Sofen cites examples of Norwegian artist Edvard Munch, Australian artist Egon Schiele, English writer Virginia Woolf, and William Shakespeare, who created their most compelling works in the midst of the pandemics of their time. Ms. Ong says these works, a small sample, offer remembrance and consolation and hope after pandemics. They are reminders that people are resilient creatures who have lived through terrible times and will thrive again. These core beliefs about the importance of the arts are fundamental if we are to continue to develop and manage student artists in the new normal. Here are some thoughts which I must admit are really initial, but I would like to offer them up for your consideration. I believe that it is important to cultivate greater efforts in arts advocacy by the student artists. If the arts are their future, then they would need to defend its importance to policymakers. This should be supported by research using data-centric methodologies to demonstrate proof of concept. If data is the language that the world is speaking, we must learn to speak that language. We need to also align our arts learning with educational goals of our institutions without compromising the integrity of what we do in the arts, but showing that through the arts, we are supporting the same objectives and therefore deserve the same resources. If we were to focus upon projects, programs, and productions as final outcomes, the lack of certainty in the new normal will frustrate us further. However, when we begin to shift to talk about process, it generates a positive perspective of what we do. Documentation and sharing of best practices becomes the rich soil in which seeds will grow in due time. The biggest challenge is to stay motivated, to stay hungry, and to stay inspired in the new normal. I'm going to share a little bit about what we are doing in NUS Center for the Arts, about how we are attempting to manage and develop our student artists. Our vision is to be a vibrant space to experience the arts and to nurture creative minds and inquiring spirits. And to this end, we seek to incorporate the arts to every aspect of university life, offering opportunities for exchange, discovery, and action. We comprise the NUS Museum and Barber House, the University Cultural Center, and the Talent Development and Programming Department, which looks after the development of 20 student arts groups. While efficient administration, creative skills in performance, and marketing result in an artistically strong show, and these are important, we are conscious that our objectives are not just about performance. Here you'll see a figure that sets out the strategies for the development of 21st century competencies through co-curricular programs. This Swiss role was created for grades between primary one to pre-university, but guide us in thinking about our desired outcomes. 3 years ago, we introduced a framework for training in our groups, and our trainers have progressively adapted this according to the needs of their groups, and annually we review their training plans. The four pillars are skills and techniques, contextual learning, knowledge and perception, transferable or soft skills. Most of you would already be familiar with training in artistic skills as well as contextual studies. In terms of knowledge and perception, we have stretched our students further by encouraging them to integrate research into the creative process. The key platform for this is our NUS Arts Festival that covers 3 weekends every March. This is a list of faculties and research institutions which we have collaborated with and include the Global Asia Institute, the Center for Quantum Technology, the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences, as well as the Faculty of Sciences. What do these collaborations look like? In 2015, Mrs. Basker was appointed the Outreach Fellow for the Center for Quantum Technology. She spent hours reading up on the topic, consulting regularly with the researchers. During rehearsals, the researchers would sit in to provide inputs as the show took shape, and students were exposed to the concepts in quantum physics. While not all fully grasped knowledge about photons, electrons, and entanglement, the students welcomed the opportunity to examine how scientific concepts could be translated into Bharatanatyam. Ilsa Tari chose to explore the theme of women in Malay dance. They approached Dr. Suryani Suratman from the Department of Malay Studies. Dr. Suryani ran seminars and workshops which helped the students to think through the key issues and encouraged the students to keep reflective journals on the project. One of the students wrote his final year thesis on the theme, and the topic was raised at a symposium that featured the choreographer, the student originators, and a female practitioner prior to the screening of their digital production. Allowing the students to initiate the research and study of the themes lent greater ownership of the work. Last year, we saw the pilot of our first Design Your Own module, or DYOM. Members of Dance Synergy created a self-directed learning module entitled Helping Hands Moving Bodies, that introduced seniors to contemporary dance. The proposal was submitted. It was approved on the basis that it met the requirements. The activity was conducted over 10 weeks between August to November, and the students worked 120 contact hours to earn 4 module credits. In the coming year, we're expecting more groups to step forward. In the area of transferable skills, we place a high value on the development of leadership skills. This year, we invited Dr. Matthew Arau to be our keynote speaker for our Arts Leaders Retreat. Chair of the Music Department of Lawrence University in Wisconsin, Dr. Arau spoke about the essential qualities of an effective leader. Shortly after the Arts Leaders Retreat, we embarked on handovers and work planning. And instead of immediately diving into planning their year's activities, we asked that they review their mission, vision, and values first. We've introduced thinking about what motivates them, or the why, in Simon Sinek's The Golden Circle. In particular, we found that groups that have a clearer sense of their purpose and the impact that they want to make do better in each year. If the objectives of the work plan and activities are simply to produce good shows and to bond, most certainly these would find it hardest to adjust to the changes in the new normal. A clear sense of impact, which is their final objective and destination, motivates them to see alternate routes if one direction needs to change. For example, Blind Spot by NUS Chinese Drama, due to the cancellation of NUS Arts Festival in 2020, shows were either cancelled or postponed indefinitely. NUS Chinese Drama opted to move the production to a digital platform despite issues such as the cast being scattered all over the world, lack of acting experience in a digital production, and lack of technical skills such as editing. They were motivated by the strong message of the play, which centered upon impairment of physical sight, as well as the lack of inclusivity. As a result, they pressed in and delivered what is NUS's first Chinese language accessible digital production with dual caption for hearing impaired and audio description for visually impaired viewers. Despite the frustrating challenges of constant change that have affected rehearsals and productions, our students have done their best to adapt to these changes. This has led to many new creative ideas that they might not have considered before, rethinking who their audiences are, what their marketing strategies should be, and interesting technical innovations that they have come up with to manage the various issues. The groups that have grown in the past year are those that did not give up. You see, at the end of the day, what we are looking for are young people who love the arts and in the pursuit of the arts become stronger, more creative, more curious, and not afraid of the unknown. We give them guidance and encouragement. We give them the opportunities to try even if they fail. And wherever possible, we provide training to do what they need. The new normal is not new. We have lived in a VUCA world for some time. Uncertainty for arts and artists is not new, but we have weathered the storm. And as those who have worked in the arts, we know that life is not about waiting for the storm to pass, but learning how to dance in the rain. I'd like to conclude with a quote from a student, Erica Goh, who was the president of NUS Dance Ensemble and one of the lead dancers in the opening production of the arts festival, Past, Present and Future. She acknowledged the challenge of working for the first time with film and with dance. But she says, in a year of disconnect from NUS, I found Past, Present, Future a great outlet for me to really dig into my emotions, to reflect on the time we have with our loved ones and reconnecting with ourselves as individuals. Concepts which were universal to those affected by the pandemic. I felt more connected with NUS through this production, as it has helped me to reflect on my NUS experiences and truly feel the support and bond with CFA groups and amongst the dancers in NUS Dance Ensemble. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all the work that you do in helping student artists, Ms. Law. You are one of the reasons that we artists, arts educators, and arts managers are inspired to persist and thrive during these trying times. Ms. Law will be back along with our other plenary speakers in a few minutes for the open forum. Again, please be ready to type in your questions on the chat box. Before the break, let's continue our virtual trip to Singapore with today's performance excerpts. First up, we have a traditional Indian dance performance choreographed by Singapore Hall of Famer, Mrs. Santa Bhaskar, whom we all met last week and who is in the audience today. The excerpt you're about to see is entitled The Pulse from Sambhavna 2.0, which was staged at the National University of Singapore University Cultural Center. Sambhavna 2.0 was the second installment of an ambitious series of works by NUS Indian Dance that witnessed the amalgamation of two seemingly disparate fields, traditional Bharatanatyam and modern quantum physics. For our second performance, we have a collaboration between the Singapore Management University Symphonia and the Singapore University of Technology and Design Chamber Ensemble. With Trevorson at the baton, the two schools joined forces for Alma Mater, a production that sought to open up opportunities for musicians from both institutions to experience the importance of working in diverse teams and the beauty of sharing music together. It was initially visualized as a physical concert, but due to unforeseen circumstances, it was reconceptualized as an online concert instead. The excerpt you will see is their rendition of a classic Disney theme, that is, Tale as Old as Time from Beauty and the Beast. Finally, we will cap off these performances with another group from Singapore Management University, SMU Eurythmics, or EMIC for short, is the school's official hip-hop dance club, renowned for churning out creative signature productions since its inception in 2001. The performance you're about to see was lifted from Dawn, an 8-part dance concept video series that was innovatively staged and mounted in response to the ongoing pandemic restrictions. We present to you Wolves. Ladies and gentlemen, enjoy these performances.
பெருமையாருக்கு தெரியும் உயிரே. Get them. That's right.
I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. 8 to they fool. Run through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack, that's risk in your life. Better play it right, yeah, you better play it right. I got loyalty and blood. I do anything for love and everything for us. Doing everything like everything ain't been too much. You know my favorite time to come through for you is the clutch. Last second, what a rush. Look, I'm the type to talk to the stars. Straight up, these ain't tattoos, these are scars. My young dogs will tear you when the witness is apart. They care about starving more than they do by the charge. Me, I can't break a commitment. I done seen people f*** up the whole team cause they couldn't play their position. Talking about dating meaning, but you know the road ahead was paved with good intentions. I see myself and my nemesis. I contemplate in forgiveness. I think I lost all my innocence. Yeah. My life depend on this. This ain't no simple sucker shit. Try stealing, you get bit. That's what you motherfucker get. I feel safer taking risks, and I can't eat this on my own life. Put my back against the wall just to see how much I grow, dog.
I was raised by the wolves, 8 to they fools. Running through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack, that's risk in your life. Better play it right, better play it right.
On my wrist, ice in my veins, but it's a cold, cold world, and you could be predator, you could be prey.
I was raised by the wolves, 8 to they fool, run through the night, playing with your life, go against a pack that's risking your life.
Thank you.
Enjoyed the performances from Singapore, thanks to the performers from the four groups. To our Zoom audience, feel free to comment on the chat box and or use the emoticons found on the lower right of your screen. If you're watching via Facebook, feel free to comment as well. Ladies and gentlemen, we are down to the final part of today's program. As mentioned earlier, we will hear from our plenary speakers once again as they answer your questions. We will now proceed with the open forum. I would like to call back today's speakers, Ms. Mary Law Chu Kwan, Mr. Chris Millado, and the Head of Arts and Creative Industries for British Council Philippines, Ms. Malaya Del Rosario, to fill in for Ms. Julie Kim-Davies. Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Good morning. Hello, good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for being with us for this portion where we will get to interact with our audience via Zoom and Facebook. To our audiences, please use the chat box to post your questions or comment also on Facebook. Our first question comes from John Paolo Barcelona of the Pamantasan ng Lungsod ng Marikina here in the Philippines. And this question is addressed to you, Chris. Hi, Sir Chris, thanks for the talk. We were all astonished by the pandemic and the online setup is a huge adjustment to create a show. I'm just curious, how challenging and expensive are the CCP's migration to digital production? And are there any future plans to collaborate with more universities and colleges in the last two quarters of 2021?
Before anything, congratulations, everyone, for putting this event together. And I think this is a fine example of how we can best use this technology during this time. And I hope, you know, we harness the best qualities of this kind of sharing, even emerging out of the pandemic. To answer the first part of the question, how expensive it is to migrate online, it is, I would say it is quite expensive. And at the same time, it could also be inexpensive. It is expensive in the sense that if I'm talking about the institution, we're looking at a huge body of assets. And it needs, of course, you have to take into consideration equipment, which is hardware. You have to take into consideration software, and you have to take into consideration training and skills of people. But of course, I'm talking in terms of institution-wide, large-scale pivoting. And an example of this would be the Encyclopedia of Philippine Arts, which started like 5 years ago. But if you're looking at Zoom, forums, workshops like this, it can be inexpensive. it can also, it can, and I'm sure you've already like experienced this, that you can easily tap into existing technologies as well as existing software. I think the most important thing to remember is internet connection. Even though how expensive and how great we are, if our internet connection is not up to par, then this could pose a real challenge. In terms of what we're preparing for the last quarter of 2021 for universities, our main thrust is the Encyclopedia of Philippine Arts. We're working now with the Department of Education and other private institutions so that they could provide free access to the Encyclopedia of Philippine Arts to all of our students to be used by their teachers in enhancing their curriculum, especially in the arts.
Thank you, Chris. I actually have a question, and it's for you and for Mary. With regards to your music ensembles, whether it's your resident orchestras or other music groups, were the musicians able to bring home their instruments during lockdown to rehearse? If not, how were they able to continue to rehearse and practice their respective instruments, particularly the larger instruments?
With regard to that, I think in the initial part of the lockdown, we had actually locked down fairly early because we actually started our own, we had to work from home, and students, all the rehearsals was canceled from February of last year. And so what happened was that, of course, then everyone broke for examinations and stuff like that. And so it was only after they came, it was only about June, then we kind of like realized that there was a problem because they could not practice without their instruments. And so in preparation for, of course, you know, school term would open up, etc., what we did was to actually arrange for the students to borrow some of the instruments to take home as well. Of course, this kind of became a less of a problem when we were able to open up for, there was a slight relaxation of the rules that would then say that they could come back in groups of and form firstly groups of five and of course groups of eight, and they of course had to be masked. There were all kinds of restrictions, but that kind of like then meant that they could still practice to some extent. But again, the restrictions are complicated because in terms of the numbers, how you move people in and out of rooms, to actually then make sure that nobody's kind of like, you know, in larger groups, and there's you can't go to the toilet at the same time as somebody else. It was all very, very complicated. It was like playing Tetris. But in the end, we've actually managed to get them to focus and do more quartets, more quintets, more smaller ensembles. And that's actually how they've actually managed to get around all these restrictions to create their online shows. So yeah, that's what we've done. Yeah.
May I, for the Philippine Philharmonic Orchestra, which is the official orchestra of the Cultural Center, it's a 70 member orchestra. Fortunately, all of our instrumentalists, all our musicians have their own personal instruments because they're not allowed to take out the government-owned instruments. So throughout this whole period in lockdown, they've used their personal instruments. Although I'd like to share another project that we had. This time it was with guitarists. These are young youth guitarists who we used to support even before the pandemic. We were able to mobilize donations to not only give them their own guitars that they so that they continue to practice in their homes, but also we were able to ask for donations so that they are provided internet service and their own small iPads so that they could continue to receive instruction from home.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Mary. We now have a question for all of you. And it goes, what are the learning tips you can provide to mount a quality and engaging virtual event or show?
Maybe I can start with this one.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, that's an interesting question, because obviously like an event that you may be planning will have a particular audience. So at least from the British Council, what we try to do is to really get to know and be sure who we are trying to target through our activity or an event. And based on that, and of course, what are the objectives that we want to come out of an activity? And then based on that, we come up with an event design on how we can reach out to these audiences. It's good to know their demographics, obviously. You know, are they what age range they are from? Are they, you know, mostly women or men? What time zones are they coming from? Because, you know, in this new way of working, we're able to reach out, you know, across different time zones. So based on all these questions, you can design an event or an activity that will really first, attract your audience. And then you can start adding on different engagement activities to make sure that, you know, you are inviting them to be part of the discussion. For us, it was a huge learning curve at the British Council. We had to transition, especially last year, probably 100% of our activities online. So I guess it was all, another tip is to be kind to yourself. You know, it will be a lot of hits and misses in the beginning. Some of the things will work, some will not work, but I think it's also important to learn from what worked and what didn't work. And, you know, obviously we use a lot of tools, you know, like Zoom, Teams. I think it's important also to be inclusive with your audience, make sure that they are able to get the proper information about your event, you know, to give them clarity instead of confusing them with information, obviously, because there are also many activities happening at the same time. So, you know, just some practical tools like sending joining instructions so they know, you know, the Zoom credentials and what to expect in the program flow. And then, of course, it's good to have a host, I think, to really start off conversations and invite people to contribute to the chat. Offline, you know, beyond a Zoom meeting, we've also tried to do some creative things, such as commissioning artists to respond to content that we have, portraits of our speakers. So we've been trying to be really creative and engage our audiences, not just through an event, but through wider digital communications campaigns.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Del Rosario. Would any of our other speakers care to answer the question?
Just sharing a bit of from our own experience, when we had to pivot over to digital productions, at that particular point of time, none of us knew what was required in a digital production. There was a lot of work, and I want to thank my own colleagues, especially Jobina Tan, who was the first person to kind of jump in and do all the research. And at that point of time, even the professional arts companies had not even, many of them had not even ventured into the whole entire idea of digital transformation of their artworks, and people were just making archives and basically putting it online, and it would just be like 1 hour, etc. What we did was we, of course, jumped in with both feet, our eyes open, and of course, so one important tip is you need to just try first, and then you know exactly what your audiences want, not to be afraid of. And of course, the question is, do you need fancy cameras? Do you need like green screens, et cetera, et cetera. Start small, and of course, then you kind of like progressively grow. One of our groups, Electronic Music Lab, they knew that they had to shoot from home, but what they did was come up with creative things like project images onto themselves in their rooms. So it's a firstly, it's a lot of experimentation. It is also definitely what, Ms. Del Rosario says, it's a steep learning curve, but a journey of 1,000 miles begins with your first step. So you need to firstly start. The whole entire question then becomes not just about the final show, but the whole entire lead up to the show. Your marketing has kind of like, and of course, then the question then, if the final show is this digital product, and of course, then what then becomes your final, what is the show? Because I think that one of the big questions that we've been asking ourselves is, what is the product? Now we talk about marketing, the four P's, what is your product? And so I find that kind of like your promotion and your product has become merged into one in this kind of like new normal. And so I think it is about looking at that, looking at consumer behavior. I think one of the very key things is that we've learned is that I may be able to sell 1,600 tickets to a audience or they're coming for a live show. All right. But when it go on to digital platforms, the number kind of like drops. So this is kind of like our challenge. And so you have to accept the fact that not everybody is going to go digitally to come and watch your show. And it's a case in which if your audience is your family would come, you know, like when you are performing, you have your father, your mother, brothers, sisters, uncle, grandparents, et cetera, you might have a party of six to come and see your show. But when you go onto the digital platform, your parents may not be tech savvy. Your grandparents are not going to gather in front of the television to watch you unless you screencast it. But that means that the numbers, of course, viewership kind of like drops. And so for us, the marketing of it and also your expectations and who you kind of like think is your audience, it needs really, really careful investigation. It really, really needs about who am I reaching and why am I doing this, which is why we go back with the start with why. So ask yourself, why am I doing this? What do I intend to achieve? And of course, the whole entire technology is your medium. It's not your be all and all also. And that kind of takes time to actually evolve. And it's not about, at the end of it all, it's really, really, I've actually seen productions that are really, really less technically complicated, but have larger number of audiences because it says something. So I think that's very important. Yeah.
May I share something, Martin?
Yes, please do.
We had a very interesting finding in some of our really like disparate ways of presenting content at the CCP. We put in almost like a really big budget for a highly polished, we hired a video team to video and it took like 2 days of shoot. It was a 3-minute dance and video. And when we premiered it, it just practically attracted less than 1,000 views. And then we put up another project. This time it was just a 3-5-minute piece and practically very casual. And it just involved 10-year-olds asking 10 questions to established artists in order to guess what kind of arts they were involved in. So it was very cute, engaging, funny, and spontaneous. And that immediately like garnered the first time we published it, more than 1 million. And wow. we spent almost nothing. You know, so it brings to the point that, you know, the internet and what we're doing right here in terms of migration, we cannot just simply like transfer what we know of marketing performing arts live to this whole platform. And I go to the idea of how we could really maximize this page in Facebook called analytics, you know. And that's where we started to begin to really refine how we engage online. So one of the findings was that, one, it is as mentioned by Malaya, it's very important to know your audience. You cannot just like put out something out there like and wish that there would be so much engagement from all sides. The more specific you are in terms of your content and knowing who you're specifically talking to, this time we're talking to 10-year-olds, and maybe their parents and guardians, then the content became more engaging. Second, it needs to be shorter. People online have shorter attention spans, you know? So when we came up with shorter content, we had bigger chances of engagement because we saw that in the analytics, people stayed on not longer than 1 minute, you know? And 3 minutes would be a some sort of a breakthrough. That means they stayed on for 3 minutes. 5 minutes is really excellent, you know? But you cannot sustain these kind of numbers and length of times at the same time. Third, there should be like some sense of participation. You know, so we're seeing 12-year-olds, 10-year-olds talking and having like a thread where, you know, viewers could throw in more questions helped a lot. Fourth, the casualness of it. I guess people are watching from their beds, from their living rooms, from their living spaces. So I guess the more casual and the more it becomes accessible to a lot more people. So these were just some of the findings that we had. It doesn't mean that you really need to put in a big budget and really quote unquote polished work. And I guess we get the sense of this called TikTok casualness of everyone. And if you are able to somehow appropriate these characteristics to market our own ideas and our content, we might be going somewhere in terms of how we are translating performing arts experiences to these online platforms.
Chris, as a follow-up, if the attention span of our audiences have really become so short, 3 minutes to 5 minutes, how do you do a concert with multiple pieces or production numbers? And what would be the ideal number of pieces or songs or the total length of the concert?
If we plan to do a two-hour concert, and I've watched some of these on YouTube, for example, you have to make sure that this becomes a really engaging 1 hour and a half well-made concert. Remember, when we put something out there, we're not competing anymore locally. We're competing internationally and globally. And our products become, we have to compete with the standards of what's out there in terms of 1 hour and 2 hour shows. So if we want to succeed in longer content, especially if you put it on a YouTube platform, then I think this is the time when we need to put in a bit more effort, a bit more budget, so that we come up with a very polished, engaging, well-curated show that will engage the millions that we'd like.
Thanks, Chris. We now have a question from Jess Montajes from Ateneo de Davao University's Culture and Arts Cluster. He says, good day to our speakers. Thank you for the sharing. How do we further address and somehow lessen the digital divide in the pandemic times, specifically the shift to online teaching and learning in the Southeast Asian context?
May I start with that?
Yes, please.
Important question, actually. So I mean, just to say that, you know, equality, diversity, and inclusion are fundamental pillars of the British Council. So we really try to be as inclusive as possible through our programs. I think when you're talking about digital divide, it's also good to see that, you know, technology can do many things, but it's primarily a tool for us to connect and communicate with each other, right? And so what we want to do is to be able to communicate with groups through technology, but also, you know, outside of technology. I'm just going to give an example of one project that we have called Crafting Futures, where we're actually trying to engage artisanal communities in more remote areas in the Philippines, right? And of course, you know, there's a lack of infrastructure there. Internet access is not very easy to get. So knowing that, what we did was to engage partners on the ground. So, you know, so I guess it's important to note that social media won't solve all your engagement problems, right? Again, you need to know who you're trying to reach. So what we did was we actually well, we had to find local partners who would then connect with the communities of artisans, and then make sure that, you know, there was another hub, a central hub, where then they could gather, connect to Zoom, and from there, you know, so we created like different clusters instead of assuming that each artisan or maker would have access individually to a laptop or a smartphone or to the internet. And that's one way of bridging the digital divide. You know, it's not, the solution is not always internet. Sometimes the solution is, you know, community engagement and logistical, you know, design. Of course, other means would be, again, to make sure that your production or your event is trying to speak to all types of audiences. You can you know, make sure that you have closed captions. You know, I think some maybe Zoom or Teams, you can actually put automatic subtitling as a feature. So, you know, you can even invite people speaking another language through technology. But then you would also need to bridge that digital divide through, you know, through the technology. And then, of course, it's important to note that, you know, with technology and with digital means of communications, there are also the risks are increased, but also the opportunities are increased. So I think it's important to adapt a mindset that you are speaking to different audiences with very different positions, very different contexts, different time zones. Once again, some might actually be logging in with, you know, children beside them because they need to stay home and take care of their children. So I think it's important to note that when you're planning your event, that you're dealing with different personal situations of people also. And then to try to respond to these different needs through your inclusive considerations.
Martin, with regards specifically the experience of the CCP Encyclopedia of Philippine Arts, we've developed an online edition, which is available, of course, for people who have internet, and it's responsive to both mobile phones and laptops. But then again, it presumes that you have this kind of hardware, which in the Philippines is not difficult to imagine, because we are the most findings show that what a Filipino owns. Average Filipino owns almost every Filipino owns a cell phone, even in the hinterlands. Although we do recognize that there are still some areas which are not connected yet, so we address that by developing what we call offline versions of the encyclopedia, which are USBs that you don't need an internet for accessing the content of the encyclopedia. But of course, you still need the hardware. Right, and you still need a hardware that is able to process it in a way that the content can be viewed in the best way. So we also address this gap by beginning to talk and collaborate with suppliers who would be able to donate or at least subsidize certain equipment that could find its way to these areas which have no internet connection and could facilitate the use of these offline USBs to the content. So these are the some things that we've done to make digital content more accessible.
Thanks, Mary. Yes, would you like to share?
Yeah, just very quickly. I think one of the key issues about the digital device, firstly, of course, the possession of the actual devices, and the second part of it is the problems with the internet, and of course, with the technology itself. If you want to teach dance. How do you actually capture hand movements, especially in Asian dance? Because we have, you know, we have hand gestures, we've got the body, and as well as the feet. And so no camera can capture that kind of like thing. So it's these three things, the device, the whole entire problems of the device being able to capture, you know, any one thing, and of course, lag in internet. And I think that one of the things that we have done is, I think one of the things that we have had to do was also focus upon more contextual studies. The second part of it was to look at whether or not there was offline. So I might not, the assumption is that with online teaching, it's live, and there is some level of feedback from the student to the teacher and the teacher to the student, all right? So if we basically take that and basically say, I'm putting the videos online for you to learn, and then of course, then the teacher can actually focus upon, you know, how you're actually doing your fingering exercises or whatever, the technical parts of it are actually encapsulated and put online when the students can actually access that. The students practice and send back the videos for dance or music. That's one of the ways to actually overcome that. And it also overcomes the fact that you don't need a large screen. You can still do it over a phone. All right. So that, I think it's about, again, adapting what we have to the problems. And of course, we, you know, in Singapore, we're a little bit more privileged in the sense that we don't have, well, we still have problems with internet. I will not mention which phone companies give me heck. But anyway, I think it is about then accommodating those kind of like needs. Because I think that in other countries, there is greater problems with brownouts, with internet, I mean, unreliability of internet, et cetera, that may make these problems greater problems than in their particular circumstances. But these are some of the ways that we've kind of like done to address this problem. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Our next question is from Zafri Arif from Brunei. In terms of online performance, what is the best practice to get some financial benefits through ticket selling? Chris, looks like you want to start.
I'm afraid there is no best practice for monetizing online. In fact, we've been losing a lot of revenue online, and always our main thing is that when we produce for online, it's practically, we don't look at it as a revenue project. More than the objective has always just been sustaining or continuing the relationship with audiences and viewers, as well as between artists and audiences too. Remember most of the content, even by the most established companies abroad, have been offered for free online, and if not on a donation basis. But as you know, donations, also a lot of our donors, especially in our context here in our part of the world, we don't have as much philanthropists that could sort of even out the cost that we do for these productions. So no, there is no best practice yet for monetizing online performing arts events. If we've had any success in the past, it barely covers a fraction of what we usually, what it costs us to produce these events.
I think this is where, why I actually ask our students to focus upon their why. The actual performances themselves will be hard to monetize, but I think that the performances become a platform in which they can market themselves to show the kind of work that they do and the impact that they want to make, which then allows them to then say, if you believe in the work that we do, would you like to give to the work? And so, you know, I mean, my favorite example right now is BTS, which everybody goes, yay. BTS, when they released their album recently, single Butter, within 24 hours, it reached 113 million viewers on YouTube. And I kind of like ask myself, okay, yes, there are seven cute looking guys. Yes, it's a very snappy song. But I think that the magic of BTS is because they stand for a lot more than themselves, more than performances, etc. They talk about diversity, etc., etc. And these are the causes that people kind of like say, oh, you know, because I listen to their music, agree with their views, I like their view of the world, and therefore I support them as a group. And then that's why I'm not, of course, turning all our groups into BTS, but the whole entire point is that people will give if they realize that your group is doing something that needs to be supported and is worth supporting. So the performance is one part of it, and that's where also in this current phase, this transition, it may not be the performance itself that people will want to give to or are prepared to pay money for, not yet at least, but they will support if the cause or the impact that you are planning to make or hoping to make is something that is close to their hearts. So that's how I have shifted our thinking about doing why we do performances online. Yeah.
Malaya, would you like to add to the discussion?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. And I think next week we will also be sharing a course that we developed called Ways to Monetize Your Services, which is one of the courses that we developed as part of our digital transformation at the British Council. I think, obviously the arts and cultural sector has been greatly impacted by the pandemic. But saying that, there is still value that's being created. Maybe it's just going to other places, right? We have retailers and artists who maybe have less access to grants or government support but on the other hand, other areas of what we call the creative industries are gaining increasing in value, you know, like streaming platforms, Netflix, I think, you know, they have found new meaning during this time, and definitely their valuation is proving that. So I think it's important to evaluate or reevaluate the value proposition, the cultural product or the service that you are trying to promote. Maybe people are still wanting to engage or consume what you're trying to offer, but in a different way. So I think it's a good time to reevaluate how we can share and prove the value of our product in a different way. I think IP, making the most out of IP, intellectual property, is one thing that's gaining a lot of traction, not just in the Philippines, but in Southeast Asia. How can you really, because it's about existing content, right? That maybe you are not making the most use of currently through IP. They call it IP exploitation, which is kind of a strange word. But yeah, there's definitely a lot of opportunity to explore how you can make the most out of your IP. I think some of the cultural organizations and creative hubs we work with, they have definitely pivoted their business model. You know, some of them before they were mostly doing retail, online. Of course, now they've amped up their online retail e-commerce, but they've also introduced like Patreon accounts. I don't know if you've heard of Patreon. It's a new platform where it's kind of patron focused, where you allow people who want to support an artistic or cultural cause and support through this app. So yeah, there are also new ways that you can kind of create new value.
You know, if I can also share, I was involved with a fundraising concert online for art scholarships, and the organization used Zoom as the platform for the concert, but they asked a suggested donation for a link. And then depending on how many links they wanted or how many how much they were willing to donate, they got equivalent number of links as tickets to this online concert of classical music. And it surprisingly raised quite a lot of funds, with viewers watching from all over the world. And that was really one of the beautiful, I guess, things that comes out now of online concerts. But that leads to the next question, and that would be then talking about intellectual property rights and having online concerts and then charging for tickets will also open a whole can of worms when it comes to paying for royalties and licenses. And in your experiences, producing digital content, has that been an issue, or has that been something you had to factor in preparing your online content? Whether paying for the rights for the music or the music used for dance, or even for background music in a PowerPoint presentation or online presentation? Was that even a consideration?
In Singapore, one of our, this is actually one of the key areas which is undergoing some discussion and debate. And of course, we do have a situation where if we pay royalties, it's easy to calculate it when it's in a theater where we're talking about 400 yes. people, or and the minute you put it in, on online, they assume that you have the capacity to be seen by millions. And therefore, they will charge you a phenomenal sum of money. And but I think the problem becomes even, is it a local collector? Is it the who owns the rights? Because there is, of course, transmission rights. There's rights to the work, etc. And so we are still sorting out that in a very, very complex world where the rights to the work belong to the actual owner of the rights, but there's also the, like, for example, a particular group may have that, but Warner Brothers may actually have, like, we did Prince of Egypt, which was a virtual orchestra thing. There was, of course, the people who owned the rights to that, and of course there was the people who made the film that owned some level of the rights, and of course there was a local collection agency that collected on everybody's behalf. And so it takes like levels of, so we tell our students, if you want to use that, then be prepared that you need at least a 3 months sort of things to basically find out who at the end of the day you have to pay, and you might end up having to pay two or three different groups. Now the other problem is that you may have actually licensed your production and done the due diligence, found the right people and paid, but because of the algorithms in YouTube and Facebook, you may actually have your production, the particular production actually just cut off, because they think that, you know, the coordination between the rights owners as well as the agencies that are trying to make sure that it's not pirated hasn't been also, they haven't kind of like figured that out as well. So you may have paid for the license, you may have actually kind of paid the local agency as well as the owners of the copyright, but Facebook didn't get the memo, or YouTube didn't get the memo, and of course in the middle of a YouTube live performance you could get completely just cut off. So they haven't worked it out. I don't think that it's something that's going to be easily and quickly worked out together. And of course the whole entire question that for us, we are not here to make millions of dollars when we put any production online. We are here to basically give our students an opportunity to showcase their work, to get feedback as well. And so there's an educational purpose, but we are charged at the same levels as professional agencies. And that's, again, a very, very important question as to how we can actually negotiate this on a more in a collective way, to do collective bargaining for things like that. Because we have heard that, just because for a 1 week performance, a particular higher education was asked to pay a phenomenal amount. And of course, then if you do that, then what happens? So the challenge becomes that you either end up having to create your own music, original music, or then, find ways around it to find other channels or other streams of like other platforms that you can actually present your work, so that you don't get stopped by all these algorithmic patterns. So it is a very, very complicated question. I think that hasn't been resolved and should be resolved.
At the Cultural Center of the Philippines, we've put up what we call a legal desk. And this is this desk, practically their only function is to scrub everything in terms of copyrights, licenses, and everything. And that desk has been very busy since we pivoted online. And they've also started to develop policies, started to research on copyright, and so on and so forth. And I would say that pretty much we've somehow managed to enhance our knowledge in terms of management of rights and licenses during this whole year and a half, which we couldn't imagine even before. So happily at the CCP, all of our items or assets are covered by an agreement between the content creators that we are allowed to present these assets for free as long as it's done for promotional and educational purposes. Okay, but the moment you charge for it, you need to enter into a separate agreement. And most of the time, if it's our performing arts assets, Mary has mentioned, it's difficult really to monetize this and to sort of even break even if you monetize these. But we have a different experience with film because, you know, CCP also has film festivals. So on film, we are more successful in terms of royalty fees and crafting contracts that consider not only that are done within a screening within a time frame, time bound, and even geographically bound. So for example, films can only be shown and can be accessed within a certain geography in the Philippines so that it allows the filmmakers to monetize their content if they so decide to put their content in another international platform. You know, so somehow we're learning a lot of things because of this whole pivot, which you could apply post-pandemic.
Yeah, I think maybe just to add, from the British Council's perspective, this is a very big topic, IP, and we try to always incorporate IP clauses in every contract that we have because obviously we're working with artists all the time. But it's also as important within the education sector, right, where you have a lot of books and literature being produced all the time. But what's surprising is that many creators, artists, content creators, writers, they themselves don't necessarily understand what their rights are when it comes to their copyright, right? And they don't necessarily realize that they can actually, translate this into another form of income. And we're not just talking about maybe like a book or a film, but in some, I guess, industries or groups where the IP, the use of IP is more mature or more established, you can also make derivatives from your content, you know, from a book, you can translate this to a film, to posters, you know, to a whole enterprise. And I think that's when IP becomes a real source of issue. When the use of IP becomes more and more complex. But I think that can be easily resolved if the parties involved in the use of content are clear from the very beginning on who owns their rights, has the right been transferred to another party, what about project intellectual property. So it gets very technical, I think in each of our countries there should be a desk that we can consult for advice as we kind of go deeper into this and, you know, use digital content more and more.
And we will actually go deeper into the topic of intellectual property rights in our next session next Friday. So we hope that you will all come back and tune in to our Crosslight session. We have one final question. Actually, we have quite a few, and the rest of the questions that will not be asked will be sent to you so that you can also answer them separately. But this question now comes from Anna Piquero of the University of Asia and the Pacific. Now that vaccinations are ongoing, what are your plans for future arts? Are the plans veering towards going back to live, gladly discarding the virtual, or are there plans to develop and utilize virtual as well?
I'm going to start. At the beginning of this year, we had our NUS Arts Festival, and of course, we had some level of restrictions about whether how many people we could actually have in a space. And I think the venue has the venue size maybe 1,600, but we were only allowed to have 250. It was very, very late in the day that we were told that we could have a live component. So all the way up to their preparations, the students were actually told that it could either be live or it could be or digital or hybrid. And so what had happened after that was then Okay, so the whole entire idea of defining what a hybrid production is also something that's open, that's still being developed. So for example, if it's a case in which I have kind of like thought that I'm not going to have the chance to do a digital production, I would then go and prepare for the digital, a live performance, I would then prepare for a digital performance. But what happens if suddenly the opportunity opens up and I have the chance to do that? That whole entire nimbleness about jumping from one into the other takes a certain sense of how do I then create my work so that it is possible for us to do it both ways and to actually creatively do a digital production that can be made into a live production. A digital into live may be a little bit easier. Live into digital takes a little bit more because you're talking about camera angles and et cetera. But I think what some of the groups did then was to then, in our opening production for our arts festival, past, present, and future, what they did was they incorporated the digital film into the live dance. So it became both. You could interact. If we had been in a situation in which we were not allowed the live production, we would have had a digital film to present. But when we had the live presentation, it then became the opportunity to add texture, the live performance, interacting with the dance film that gave a texture about it. So there is no one way about it. I don't think that the lessons that we've learned in digital film have also, in terms of the digital media, have been valuable. And I don't think we want to throw it away. I think it then also, the other thing that becomes possible, I think is one of the questions that talking about how, even in a very crowded a space where there are so many possibilities, it's about then saying, okay, right, fine, you've seen some of the things that we've done, we've kind of like presented that online. If you want to see more, go on to NUS Center for the Arts, our channel on YouTube, and you can see more of the productions. So as we continue to share, like saying, okay, right, fine, what's Far Eastern University doing, what is you know, we actually now have access to so much wonderful content that we never had before. So why do we want to kind of say, okay, go back to our old ways of doing things and just create live performances for our own small audiences when we have this opportunity? So I think it's hybrid. I think it's choosing stuff that can go out. I think it's finding platforms that we can actually say, hey, you know, go and watch this, because I think this is worth watching. It's sharing and also then saying that we are also creating possibilities. I think it's too early to know when we will completely not have problems with COVID or any other kind of pandemics. But as I said, the learning has been so valuable, we shouldn't throw it away. Yeah.
Malaya?
Yeah, I mean, I think there were so many new innovations that happened, right, when we went into quarantine. And and some of them are really very beneficial. And I sincerely hope that we don't go back, that we don't go backward once again. You know, I'm just thinking of all, I think I read somewhere in the Philippines that digital transformation was fast-tracked by 5 years because of the pandemic. And I sincerely hope that, you know, all these automated processes don't stop just because the quarantine is lifted. But with the British Council, there are many compelling reasons why we should maintain or even increase our digital work. But, you know, I'm not necessarily saying that we should only be digital, right? Because face-to-face interaction is still super valuable. But yeah, I mean, you know, just think of the environmental, you know, your carbon footprint when you're traveling all the time. And through our, because we're a cultural relations organization, we actually, we're used to, you know, inviting delegates to go to this country, to that country, and vice versa. That's probably going to be rethought now, you know, not just because of cost, but, you know, for environmental reasons. And because in a way we've proven that we can do things even digitally. And of course, there are the other advantages of having a stronger digital programming is you can reach wider audiences, right? Of course, this, as I said earlier, this is not the only solution to engagement, but definitely this is a very big opportunity to reach audiences that you won't normally get to reach through face-to-face engagement. Yeah, I mean, obviously the trends are still developing, right? This is only 1-2 years on. And I'm pretty sure that, you know, there are still many platforms being developed and new ways to interact. I think there's a marketing term called omni-channel marketing, right? This omni-channel meaning a blended way to engage with your audiences. So you're kind of offering engagement seamlessly from digital to physical. And you allow your audiences to connect with you through different platforms. So I think this is definitely an interesting trend, and it will only make interaction better with their audiences.
Thank you, Chris.
Yeah, speaking from the perspective of a performing arts center, the core of our work is really defined by interaction and the presence of both audiences and viewers in a space. That what makes it electric, that what makes it that the interaction and the liveness very important. So during this whole pivot, it has been very clear with us that everything that we do anticipates the return to the live performing arts center. So if we do online training for our dancers, it's because we want to sustain their muscles. So physically they are prepared when we return on stage and the muscles do not atrophy. And the same thing with the training of musicians. If we continue to create content, digital content for the youth and for audiences of the symphony and theater, it's because we want to sustain that connection all throughout this pandemic while we cannot go live on stage. While our venues are closed, what we did was we used that opportunity to upgrade our physical venues, change the carpets, install new lights, rearrange the furniture, put in a whole what we call a safety protocol guide, and retrain our front of house staff so that they're ready once public steps in and help in restoring the confidence of both artists and audiences in participating in congregational experiences like a live performance. What we've also started to install a new escalator. Martin, our escalator, the CCP is 50 years old, the oldest escalator in the Philippines. So finally, we've replaced it. So you can experience our new escalators once our venue opens. We've upgraded the facilities in our venues. So, you know, because the CCP is so busy during the pre-pandemic period, we had a difficult time even looking for times to maintain our venues. And this past year and a half, we seized that as an opportunity to really focus on upgrading venues and retraining staff and adding certain features to enhance the experience once people return and artists return to our venues. We will pick up on the best qualities and characteristics of this whole digital experience. And one thing for sure is, of course, seizing the opportunity to reach out beyond the complex in terms of reach of our activities. So this has taught us that, you know, in Manila, if you live in Quezon City, you almost live in another country because it takes you more hours to travel from Quezon City to CCP than going to Singapore because of the traffic. So with this online thing, I think this might be a solution in terms of streaming after so that we could broaden our audiences and so on. And of course, it has been mentioned already by Malaya and Mary about the educational reach and how digital could enhance. But I think at the core of it, it's all of these for us at the CCP at least, it is anticipation of going back to what we believe is the whole spirit of the performing, of the live performing arts, which is congregating and being together in a live space.
Thank you so much, Chris, Mary, and Malaya. I'd like to end this particular segment with a comment from Elenita Cruz of the Pamantasan ng Lungsod ng Marikina, because it applies, I think, to almost all of what we're feeling. And it goes, Sir Chris, your talk was nostalgic, emotional for me. as we think of our Kasining, our friends from our regional partners, and even our international cultural network, and how they, we, are all trying to survive. Thank you, CCP. It's one institution that keeps us inspired to face the challenges and move on. Padayon, we will survive. For the NUS, Madam Mary Law, and for our speakers from the British Council, Ms. Julie Kim-Davies and Malaya Del Rosario, thank you for sharing your best practices. You gave us hope and ideas on how to maneuver during this time of pandemic. Thank you once again for being such wonderful speakers. And a round of applause for you from our audience on Facebook and Zoom. Again, you can use the emoticons found on the lower right of your screen. Thank you very much for all those who submitted their questions. They were definitely thought-provoking. I wish we had more time to discuss all of them. Again, to our speakers, thank you for sharing your insights.
Before we
close our session, we would like to show our appreciation to today's guests. May we request our AUN and AUNCA officials, Dr. Choltis Diratiti and Ms. Chil Samorio, to open their cameras for the awarding of certificates to our keynote speakers. The ASEAN University Network, ASEAN Network, University Network on Culture and the Arts, Commission on Higher Education, and the Association of Cultural Offices in Philippine Educational Institutions, Inc., present these certificates of appreciation to today's plenary speakers, Ms. Julie Kim-Davies. Also to Ms. Malaya Del Rosario.
Thank you very much, Ms. Lai, and to Ms. Julia.
Thank you also for inviting us.
Mr. Chris Millado.
Salamat, thank you.
Thank you, Chris, thank you.
And Ms. Mary Lo Chu Kwuan.
Thank you very much, Mary.
For generously sharing their insights as plenary speakers on their respective topics for the AUNCA Crosslight Online Learning Session Day 2, given virtually this 11th day of June, 2021. Signed by Ms. Glorifin Samorio, AUNCA Chair, and Dr. Choltis Diratiti, AUN Executive Director.
Thank you very much.
Thank you once again to all our guests. At this point, may we request our attendees to turn on their cameras so we can document this occasion.
Okay, open your cameras. Wish speech, smile. Okay, second page, open your cameras, smile.
Probably four pages, given that there are 90 of us here on Zoom.
Third page, open your cameras, smile. Fourth page, smile. Okay. Wala yung ano eh, camera iba. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And this wraps up day two of Crosslight Online Learning Sessions. In case you feel you did not get your fill of today's topic, don't worry. Our discussions on arts management and artist empowerment will continue on day three next Friday. Take note that we will be upping the ante for next week's sessions because we will be simultaneously holding two separate programs, one for arts managers and one for artist teachers. As you can see, we have got all our bases covered. To those who wish to attend next week's session, here are some general reminders. Please take the time to tell us what you think of today's webinar by filling out the evaluation form, which you can access by scanning the QR code that is now flashing on the screen. Next, we have extended the call for abstracts and films and artworks for the exhibit for the Dialogues Research Forum and Crosslight Arts Festival on June 30 at 5 p.m. Lastly, for all registered day 3 participants, please expect an email from us within the next few days regarding the Zoom link and other necessary streaming links. Take note that next week, we will have 2 separate sessions for art managers and artist teachers or artistic directors. So we will send you instructions on how we will go about this. For more information on the upcoming programs of this event, visit or follow AUN's official website, www.aunsec.org, and its official Facebook page. Once again, this has been Martin Lopez of the Association of Cultural Offices and the Philippine Educational Institutions Incorporated. Thank you for joining me and all of us for day 2 of Crosslight online learning sessions. Have an excellent day and weekend ahead. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Martin.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Bye, Chieu.
Bye-bye. Bye, Lai. Thank you. Bye, Mary. Bye,
Dr. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, too.
Bye. Thank you.